HarperCollins presents The Second Woman by Charlotte Philby. Read by Kristin Atherton. Prologue. London. The day Anna dies. It is dusk. The road is not yet dark, but the early evening glow of the street lamps casts pools of light, like fingerprints, along the pavement. The figure moves quickly, heartbeat rising as the house comes into view. The wisteria that had burst with new life just a few months earlier now clings to the brick like sinew, exposed beneath the skin of a corpse. From this vantage point at the bottom of the tiled front steps, it is possible to see through the panes of glass in the front door that the hallway is dark. At the back of the house, a wall of glass overlooks the perfectly manicured lawn, rolling down towards the heath, the moonlight blotted out by the shadows of the trees. The children are not home yet, but they will be soon. There isn't much time. Hearing the faint sound of the car doors closing in the street, the figure takes a step towards the front door, flinching at the brushing of rope against skin, as the men from the car pass by and disappear up into the shadows beside the entrance, just out of sight. When they have taken their positions, there is a sharp intake of breath and then a single knock. The voice, as it calls through the letterbox, is firm. "Anna, it's me. Open the door." When she does, her expression transforms.
"What are you doing here?"
Part 1. Harry. London, the inquest. The journalists gathered inside the coroner's court are growing restless. Through the arched window of the courtroom, the leaves of the oak trees in the vestry of St. Pancras sway against a clear blue sky. But in here, there is no fresh air. The jury benches are empty, giving a ghostly quality to the room. There have been no jurors present since the inquest started. There seems to be no need in a case such as this. The inquest serving as little more than a rubber stamp to officiate an inevitable conclusion. Beneath dark beams that line a gabled roof, with blood-red ceilings and matching carpets, the 12 or more reporters squashed together along the mahogany pews at the back of the room are agitated from the heat. The coroner, seemingly unfazed at the front of the room, continues to consult her notes. On the table in front of her, which is reserved for family and friends, two women sit. The older one, perfectly still. The dead woman's mother, her body closed in on itself, as if in retreat from the world. The younger woman sits beside her, but set slightly apart, her spine poker straight, making no effort to push back the red curls that fall around her face. Behind them, the father-in-law, who wears a fedora hat, even in this heat, coughs into his sleeve. The woman next to him pulls a tissue from the pocket of her immaculate trouser suit, handing it to him, and giving his elbow a comforting squeeze.
"I'll now call my final witness."
The sound of the coroner's voice silences the ripple of impatience moving along the press benches. A young woman stills the pencil she had been absent-mindedly drumming against her notepad. Harry, a few seats along, bites his lower lip, eyes fixed ahead. His fingers touch the outline of the old NUJ card hanging from a lanyard around his neck. The summoned witness is small and sharp. He wears glasses, his nose like an upright skimming stone. The eyes of everyone in the room follow him intently as he moves towards the microphone, his manner suggesting he is savouring every moment with his captive audience. When he reaches the stand, he pauses, adjusting his microphone before repeating the oath.
I solemnly and sincerely declare and affirm that the evidence I shall give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Thank you, Dr. Blackman, the coroner says. And will you please explain to the court your relationship to Marianne Witherall? Of course. I am a psychiatrist. I was Ms. Witherall's doctor in the final 2 years of her life.
The energy in the room changes. Beneath the silence of the crowd, there is a fizz of excitement.
When you say you were her doctor, I was employed by the family. There was an intervention, if you will, not long after the birth of her twin daughters. David, her husband, was worried. So was her father-in-law, Clive Witherall.
The doctor glances briefly at the older man in the hat, seated in the benches.
Marianne, had been suffering from postnatal depression. And you treated her for her depression, Dr. Blackman? That's right. And what did that treatment involve? It was a combination of talking therapies and medication. What sort of medication? She took an SSRI, sertraline specifically, owing to the fact that Ms. Witherall was still breastfeeding at the point of commencement. It was you who prescribed the drugs?
He pauses.
Not at first. It was the hospital who suggested them initially. I oversaw the increase in dosage. She'd started with 50 milligrams per day. When that failed to have the desired effect, the daily intake was gradually increased to 200 milligrams.
Why was that?
Ms. Witherall wasn't coping. She was detached. She was struggling to bond with her children. My suggestion at this time was that she ought to seek in-house treatment, but she refused. And David, her husband, was keen to support that decision.
How long did you treat Ms. Witherall for her depression?
Just over 3 years, until she died.
And did you prescribe any other medication during this time?
The coroner asks. Dr. Blackman pauses, running his tongue over his top lip.
No.
And in your professional opinion, do you believe that Ms. Witherall was of a mental state that she might have taken her own life?
Dr. Blackman sighs regretfully.
I do.
There is a scuffle on the press benches, the excitement too much to contain. Although, whichever way, this is a story that will continue to elicit plenty of hand-rubbing on Fleet Street. Either she took her own life, or she was murdered. However you look at it, the story of the beautiful fallen heiress is gold dust, and this lot will continue to pick at the remains until there is nothing left, or until they are distracted by the smell of fresh blood, whichever comes first.
Thank you, Dr. Blackman, the coroner says crisply. Please return to your seat. The court will now adjourn for a short while so I can prepare my conclusion. If the family will leave first and wait in the family room. Members of the press, owing to your volume, please wait outside the court until you are called back.
The journalists have barely finished their second cigarettes when the coroner's officer calls them into the courtroom for her conclusion. Harry doesn't join them, slipping quietly away to the corner of the adjoining gardens until he hears the crowd being summoned back in. The coroner sits still at the front of the room, studying her hands while she waits for the final reporters to shuffle back into their seats. The woman with the red hair has her arms held protectively in front of herself. Even now, he won't let himself say her name. Anna's mother looks as though she has not moved since the onlookers cleared out before piling back in again.
I would like to start by thanking the witnesses for their time. I am satisfied that I have reached my conclusion in reference to the circumstances of the death of Marianne Witherall. In a case of suicide, there needs to be clear evidence so that the coroner is sure beyond all reasonable doubt that the deceased intended to take their own life. This is different from other conclusions, where we just have to be sure on the balance of probabilities. Based on the presence of the note, which, as we have heard, was confirmed to be in Ms. Witherall's handwriting by consultant graphologist Hannah Birch, along with the testimony of the police officers who first attended the scene, Sarah Marshall, who found the body, the forensic officer who studied the body, and Ms. Witherall's psychiatrist, Dr. Blackman, I can confirm that I am fully satisfied with the conclusion that on the date in question, Ms. Marianne Witherall died by suicide.
The woman with the red hair slumps slightly, her posture softening at the news. The older woman barely flinches. Focusing her attention on the table in front of her, the coroner continues,
I would like to offer, on behalf of the court, my sincerest condolences to Ms. Witherall's family, not least her mother and her daughters, Stella and Rose. The inquest is now closed.
Artemis, Greece, the 80s. The sun was already stretching over the port when Artemis came to, perhaps awoken by the sound of her own moaning. Or maybe it was the cloying damp of the sweat on her forehead that caused her to shiver and stir, her heart tapping out a rhythm against her ribcage. She had been deep in dreams of the earthquake, the same dream, mutated over time. The earth cracking, so that the ground opened up beneath her, preparing to draw her in. Screams quickening into a shrill vibrato. Artemis sat upright and gave herself a minute, taking in the scene, as if half expecting to find herself in the old cot bed she had slept in as a child, in the village at the top of the mountain, rather than where she had passed out the previous evening, safely tucked up, down by the water, in the same house she and her family had lived for the past 20 years. Ever since. She paused her thoughts there. Reaching for the Walkman on the side table, she pulled the headphones over her head and pressed play, hearing the click before the music seeped in. Simple minds, don't you forget about me, instantly blotting out the world around her. Sinking back into her pillow, she closed her eyes and drank in the sounds, dozing for a few minutes before standing to face the day, dressing quickly and heading out into the sun-bleached morning. It was a Saturday, mid-July. On the street, she turned right, away from the corner window of the bakery where her mother would have long been at work, away from the fishing boats bobbing at the edge of the water. She stretched her hands above her head, then reached into her bag for her Walkman. Pressing rewind, she yawned as she moved up the mountain path, towards the old village and the freshly emerging tremor lines that she could not yet see. The old village, which stood at the top of the mountain, rang with the intermittent sounds of new life that summer. 20 years after the earthquake that had taken their home and what lay inside, her father, Marcos, behaved as though this act of nature had been a cruel and cunning ploy, orchestrated by foreign developers seeking to take hold of the island on which his family had lived for generations. Even now he refused to come up here, too scared of the ghosts that lingered among the olive trees, repelled by the steady churn of diggers, as Europeans from across Germany and France predominantly snapped up property that had lain abandoned for 2 decades. Artemis despaired of and loved her father in equal measure for his unshakable loyalty to a past life. In the 2 decades since the house had fallen, taking with it his youngest child, the carcass of the building now symbolised for Marcos a physical and spiritual sacrifice. Unable to focus on the true horror of his loss, the earthquake represented not just the event that had taken away his 3-year-old daughter, but had become an emblem of a world. His world, that was now under threat from the emergence of a frivolous new Greece. To his broken mind, the earthquake was no longer an act of God, but a threat to the foundations of the land he loved.
It wasn't rational, of course. But then, what would be an acceptable...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.